Okay, so studies in the design of wireless cellular communication system, and the next topic to be covered is the cellular concept. In that cellular concept, we are going to discuss about what do you mean by base station, what is the mobile unit, and what will be the base station controller. This is a totally we are calling it as a base station control cellular concept. The next topic is the parameter which affects the cellular communication systems. What are the parameters which will affect the cellular communication systems? Okay. So then afterwards, what is the near and far effect in case of cellular communication systems? How it is going to be covered? The next topic is the power controlling. This is most important thing in a cellular wireless communication system. How you are supposed to control the power? What is the need of power controlling in cellular communication system? Okay, so let us. Somebody are waiting in my room. Okay, so let us go to the next topic. What do you mean by cellular CDMA system? Okay, in case of a cellular CDMA system, which requires the wideband spectrum or wideband channel, which is based on spread spectrum techniques, and characteristic of this wideband channel, and what are the predicting in that communication path in case of cellular systems are the path loss during the communication, and how fading is going to be taking place. So these concepts we are going to overcome in this. So in case of a cellular communication system, categorically we are going to use two types of wireless system design. One, it is going to be called frequency reusable factor based on.
Sir, can you speak a bit louder, sir?
It's louder, huh? Still not able to. That's what I am asking you.
Sir.
Now it is okay. Okay. Hello. Is it audible?
Somewhat better, sir.
Somewhat better.
Sir. Yes, sir. It is a bit slow, sir.
It is best slow.
It's better now, sir.
It's better now. Let me see. Now it is okay. Is it audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So there are basic two strategies are there in designing the wireless cellular wireless systems. One that is going to be called frequency reuse factor, based on which we are going to design it. Another one is wireless cellular concept. So as you know, in case of commercial radio and television broadcasting systems, okay, what actually they will do means these commercial radio or television broadcasting system, they will operate at a maximum power with highest possible antenna requirement will be there. One is it requires the maximum power, and another thing is the highest possible antenna in case of commercial radio communication or television broadcasting. Then what is the need of maximum power and what is the need of highest possible antenna? So the need of this is, one thing is that the most important thing is that it has to cover the maximum area. Okay. So to cover the maximum area, it means the height of the antenna will be very high. Then only it can radiate the energy to that extent. Another thing is that maximum power is required to cover that much of longer radial distance. Okay. So like this, if these in such systems, when we are using a highest antennas and maximum powers, communication modes, in such systems, the frequency used by the transmitter cannot be used by the another transmitter. That means each transmitter has to be operated at a different carrier frequency. Okay. So in order to overcome the overlapping, isn't it? So this is the factor why we cannot reuse the frequency. The most important thing is that if you want to use in such conditions, frequency reuse. There is enough geographical separation between them. Then only the radio interference is avoided. So I am getting disturbed. Huh? Okay. Okay. So this is the one factor in case of commercial radio or television broadcasting, we cannot use the frequency reuse. Okay. So next, what we are coming means the wireless cellular concept. This is second one. What I am explaining here. So in this wireless cellular concept, which is going to be achieved by dividing the whole coverage area into small cells, as I have projected here, these cells are there. So whole geographical area is divided into small cells, which will be vary in size. And when they are small in size, they require low power transmitters or small antennas so that the radio resources can be used effectively. In case of cellular, wireless cellular design strategy, the whole geographical area is going to be divided into small cells, and these cells vary in size, and also they were going to use a very low power for the power transmission, so that the whole area or a cell is going to be effectively covered. Therefore, like this, the resources can be used effectively. So in CDMA, this is what we are calling it as in CDMA, cellular wireless concept. In this CDMA communication systems, all the transmitters in the network use the same radio channels, and making the frequency reuse factor reach to 100%. Okay. Here, there is no chance. In case of commercial radio and television broadcasting, there is no chance of frequency reuse factor. It is totally 0%. Whereas in case of CDMA, you can use same frequency for any cells. So next, we'll come to the cellular concept. As I already told you, the cellular structure of wireless network consists of a cluster of cells. So there are a cluster of cells will be there. Okay. So in this diagram, I am showing a cluster. Two clusters are there. One is consisting of a four cells, another is consisting of a seven cells, right? And I'm indicating here cell one, cell two, cell three, cell four. So that means each cell, it is operating at a different frequencies. Okay, so each cell in this consists one base station, as I'm showing here, and that base station is also transmits as a transceiver. That means it will receive as well as transmits the power. Okay, with a suitable transmitting power. So as I already told you, it requires very low power because height of the antenna is very small. This is what we are calling it as a base station. So here, whatever the dots I'm showing here, so these dots we are calling it as a mobile stations. And dark line shows the current coverage and dashed line original coverage. Okay, so this is how the cell structure will be there. So these mobiles, what cell consists? One, it consists a fixed mobile station which has its own transmitting power, and it consists a mobile units scattering within that particular cell area of that particular cell. Okay, there are one is base station, and within that cell it surrounds with a mobile units, or you can call it as a user. Then how cell structure, why we have considered here hexagonal? Why can't be it is a circuit? Basically cell structure totally depends upon radiation power. Okay, the structure and shape of the cell depends upon the radiation pattern of the transmitting antenna. In most cases it has a non-uniform shape. As I am showing here, this is a real cell. It doesn't have any defined shape. So this is a real cell. Then ideal cell is going to be designed or considered as in circular shape. If you have taken considered it as a circular shape, then if you see here, if you have taken a circular shape, that means each cell is going to be overlapping adjacent cells. Okay, so in order to consider the best practice cell, fit cell, okay, that is what we are calling it as a hexagonal, that would fit into the corresponding circle, the single cell which is going to be shown as in this. Okay, so how the structure will be, the structure of the cell totally depends upon the radiation pattern of the transmitting antenna, and the structure of this is unrealistic, it is non-uniform shape. The structure of the cell is represented by a circle with a base station at the center, so that network cell usually overlaps when we are considered a circular shape. But in common practices, in order to overcome the overlapping of these circular cells, we are considering each cell must and should be in a hexagonal shape. Okay, so this is how we will represent it. Now I am coming to a mobile unit. The mobile unit, as we are representing here, it is also consisting of a trans receiver comprising of sensitive receiver and with a low power transmitter, operating in a wireless environment characterized by the multipath propagation, fading, and access interference. Okay, so this is what a mobile unit states. Okay, what are the advantages of this cellular system if you consider a geographic area into a cellular network? What are the advantages it offers? The first one, it increases the capacity. Second, reduces the base power. Third, large coverage area. Reduces the MUI, multi-path user interface. As you know, it increases the capacity. What does it mean? Okay. So whole geographical area, when you are dividing it by number of cells, and each cell consisting of its own area of transmission, with transmitting with a low power. Okay. So like this, if you are dividing the total geographic area into a number of cells, and each capacity is having a particular capacity each cell is indicating, then the total capacity will be increased. Okay, like this, the capacity of that particular cell increases, hence the total channel capacity will be increases. Reduces the base power, as already it has been geographic area is divided into a number of cells, means each cell, it covers a small area, and to transmit within that small area, we need a small antenna. So that small antenna, it requires a base power for the transmission, is also very less. So this is what we are calling it as a reduced base power of the base station. Okay. Now, as we are dividing whole geography into small cells, so the effectiveness is also increases, the large coverage area is also increases. Okay. So when you are increasing the number of cells, ultimately the so reduces the multiple user interference. Okay. So usually the cell size is 100 meters in case of cities and 35 kilometers in the countryside. Okay. Within the city, why we are going to take a cell size 100 meters means it is populated area. It requires more power. Hence, the cell area is going to be divided into a small cell set. Okay. Whereas in case of countryside, if you cover geographic area, then it may cover up to 35 kilometers. One more thing is that, as I already told you, the adjacent cells are assigned with the different frequencies to avoid the interference. That means each cell will be operated at a different carrier frequencies. Its own frequency band will be there. Okay. Like your FM stations, each is operating at a different frequencies. So like this, we are going to avoid the interference by assigning a different frequencies to the different cells. Here, the distance between the adjacent cells is given by D is equal to under root of N into R, or R into under root of N, we can, where R is called the cell radius. Cell radius means we're supposed to consider cell as a circular, then center point, you can easily measure the, what will be the radius of it. So that will be the radius. So if you have taken each center of the cell to the adjacent center of the cell, you have measured the distance between these two, that will be called a distance between the two cell centers. Now, let us consider there are n number of cells. N number of cells will be there, and each cell is consisting of a base station, one base station, two base station, three, means each cell, here I have considered only three cells, and each cell will be covered with a base station. And these base stations are controlled by a base station controller. Okay. So what is the function of these base stations? What is the function of this base station control? As you know, the base station will communicate with the mobile units within its cell, whereas the base station will be controlled by base station controller. The function of base station is to control the base stations. What is the need to control the base stations, you may ask, right? So in this case, when a mobile, when a mobile is moving from one cell to another cell, first cell to third cell, mobile is moving and it shifts from base station 1 to base station 2 or base station 3. When that mobile is shifting from base station or cell 1 to cell 3, then who has to control it? Who has to indicate that the mobile has been moved from base station 1 to base station 3 so that the base station 3 has to control the mobile? So the commands which are going to be shared to the base station to control the mobile is going to be done by base station controls. The function of base station controller is it will controls all the base stations and allocate which station has to communicate with the mobile. So as you already know, each cell has a base station, and base station provides a direct communication with the mobile phones, and their mobile may be number of base stations like to be a base station controller. Okay, there may be a number of base stations linked to the base station controller, and this base station controller will decide about the route for the mobile which will suits for that particular mobile user. What my point? Okay, the base station controller decides which route is reasonable for that mobile user. Either base station 1 is reasonable or base station 2, through the base station 2 route is reasonable, or through the base station 3 route is reasonable. Based on that, it is going to instruct which base station has to control the mobile user. Okay, that's what it's going to be called as a base station controller. Okay, so now next question first. Topic which is going to be dealing, what are the parameters which will affect in cellular communications? Parameters which will affect the cellular communications. There are two parameters are there. One, it is going to be called near and far effect. Another one is going to be called power control. Okay, so what do you mean by near and far effect? So here I have shown on diagram, this is what we are calling it as a base station, and these two are a mobile units, which one is at nearer to the base station and another one is at the far away from the base station within a cell I am talking about. Okay, one is nearer to the base station, another one mobile unit will be far away from the base station. So when this nearer mobile station will communicate with the base station, how much power it is going to be utilized? Okay, it utilized only 10 milliwatts, and here we have indicated the power, how much power it requires to communicate with this base station. For nearer mobile communication, it requires 10 milliwatts. Whereas for away mobile user, when it communicates through the mobile station, that when it will come to the base station, it will be faded to milliwatts. Now, what is happening here actually? So, in nearer user, half of the power is more than enough to communicate with the base power. Half of the power means 10 milliwatts it is using. Whereas, when away from there, it is fading and it will reaches to the mobile, it reduces to 2 milliwatts. Okay, what is happening here? The phenomena that degrades the service quality of a wireless network. So this is the phenomena by which it will degrade the quality of a services. Okay, how it will degrade? When the interference from the user transmitting near the base station overpowers the weaker signal received from the distant user, is known as the near and far effect. So this nearer user overpowers the weak signal received from the far away user. This is overlapping. So this is what we are going to call it as a near and far effect. So there is no need. So when it is nearer, it won't need 10 milliwatts. Or when it is far away, it will require more than 20 milliwatts also. So what is happening here? The base station can serve two or more users if the differences in their power levels is less than the proper process scale. Okay. When the base station can serve the users when they are in multiple. Okay. The base station can serve two or more users if the difference in their power level is less than the processing gain. Okay, it should be less than the processing gain. If it does not less than processing gain, then it will overcome. So this differences in the received power levels tends to degrade the system capacity. Okay, how it will be overcome? Okay. So, to examine near-far effect in more details, consider an interfering signal with a received power n times greater higher than the power received from the target user. Okay. So, consequently, what the most important thing here required is, how do you control the power of a nearer one mobile to that of the power delivered by the mobile user which is far away from the base station. The most important thing here is we need a power controller reactor which will control the power of the nearer mobile user to the base station to that of the far away mobile user from the base stations. It has to automatically control. So that means when it is nearer, it has to use the low power for the communication purpose. And whereas when it is far away, it has to require more power. So like this, it has to be automated. So that's what we are calling it as a power control algorithm, which is essential in controlling the near and far effect in case of cellular mobile communication. So like this, we are going to optimize the system capacity. Okay. So which will enhance the performance of the cellular communication system. So furthermore, if we use a power control technique in cellular mobile communication, okay, it will rapidly change in the path loss, user movement, power control skills. So it have to be adopted fast and accurate. Okay, so this is how what we are calling it as a cellular CDMA systems. So let us consider the power. How power control schemes is going to be adopted in cellular wireless systems. Okay. The first thing is that, as I already told you in previous slides, in order to overcome near and far effect, the power control algorithm is going to be adapted. Schemes are going to be adapted. Okay. In a cellular wireless systems, most control of the transmitted power from each mobile unit as well as from the base station. Okay. So we have to control the power at the transmitter as well as the base station, because both will have a transceiver antenna. Okay. Mobile will have transceiver antenna, and the base station will also have a transceiver antenna. The efficient power control scheme will also reduce the multiple access interference. Okay. So when it is, if you consider a single cell, okay, when you consider a multiple cell, what happens in case of single cell? Okay, the forward link is that link in which the power is transmitting from the base station to the user. That's what we are calling it as a forward link or downlink. So during which it requires no power control mechanism, since the base station transmits all the signals togetherly, so that the path loss experienced on passage to each receiver is the same for all signals. Okay. In a single cell, if it is a single cell, okay, it transmits or a downlink power to all the mobile users, so there is no need of controlling the power. Okay. Thus, the relationship between the interference and the user required single level remains as it was at the transmitter. However, when it is a multiple cells are there, as we have seen, there are number of clusters will be there. We have taken the cluster of cells, 7 clusters and 4 clusters we have taken it. So those are going to be called multiple cells. However, there are multiple cells, the user receives the interference from the multiple users, as we have studied in CDMA, how it is going to cancel out the interference by the other users in CDMA. User serving the base station's area as well as interference from the neighboring sensor. Okay. Therefore, control methods are used to allocate the power to individual user according to their exposure to the interference. Okay, when interference is having a greater power than the received signal, ultimately it is going to be dominated. So we need a control method which used to allocate power to the individual users according to their exposure? Have you experienced ever acting? So in some extent, in our Kailas campus also, in some areas, you are going to get a very weak signals. So wherever the weak signals are there, it will consume more power. The base station will extract the more power from your mobility to get the connectivity. So therefore, wherever the weak signals are there, the battery draining will take place faster. Okay, this is what the reason why the cell battery is going to be draining out. Okay, so in the reverse link or uplink, that is nothing but mobile to the base station, are exposed to different path losses defined by the distance from the mobile unit to its operating base stations. Okay, so this is what we are going to explain the cellular mobile communications. Here the user is there, from which this is your base station, mobile base station, which is controlled by mobile control equipment. Okay, base station controller, we can say it is, which is operated by us. And this is public switching telephone network, which is also becoming to the controlling operator. So there are n number of base stations. Here one is there, here one is there. So this is will organize, radiate according to the movement of the users, which base station has to control the signals of a particular user. Okay, so in this case, even if all the mobile unit transmit at the same power, their signals have different powers when they reach the base station. It's based on the distance, as I already told you. Okay, the power control in the reverse link or the uplink controls, which controls the interference from the shadowing and near and far problems, keep user transmitter power at the minimum necessary level for accepting the performance, thus prolonging the battery life in a portable handset. As this is what I mean to tell you. Okay, one, it will controls the interference by shadowing or obstacles. And another thing is that it will avoid the near and far problems, and also keep the user transmitter power at a minimum necessary level for acceptable performance, thus prolong the battery life in a portable handset. So it will increases the battery life in your handset. Okay, so how the power control is going to be achieved? There are two methods, are there, to control the power. One is going to be called open loop power control. Another one, it is going to be called closed loop power control. So there are the two schemes which will controls the power. What do you mean by open loop power control? In case of open loop power control method, the mobile unit uses the strength of the received payload on the forward link, that is from this to this, to determine what adjustment of its transmitted power on the reverse link is needed to achieve the required radio power at the base station receiver. So in case of open loop control, there is no loop. It is an open from mobile unit to base unit. Okay, so mobile unit measuring the received power, estimate the path loss, calculate the transmission power, and it will transmits to the base station. It receives it. Okay, so in this case, the mobile unit uses the strength of received power on the forward link to determine what adjustment it has to done on the reverse link. So it will calculate, mobile itself calculate a dot what distance base station is there, how much the power is required to transmit the information to the base station. So that much it is going to be adapted so that it is going to transmit the information to the base station in the reverse link. So what is the meaning of this? So if mobile unit, it has a automatic gain control system. It measures the mobile user, it itself measures at what distance it is there from the base station. It estimates what is the probability of path loss. Based on that, it will calculate how much power it is required. So that much power it utilizes to communicate to the base station. This is what it is going to happen in case of open loop power utilization. Then what is the weakness of this design open loop system? Okay, as we know, the forward and reverse links. Okay, forward and reverse links. That's what I mean to say. One is upward, another one is downward link. Okay. These links may be subjected to the different levels of path loss. Okay, forward path power will be different. And in case of reverse power, reverse link, the power will be different. When power difference will be there, the path loss will be different. And this is a weakness of open loop power control systems. Whereas in case of closed loop power control systems, the base station provides each mobile unit with the continuous information about the power of their signals. What is happening here? In case of closed loop power control, the base station providing to each mobile unit with continuous information about its power, with rest, so that according to that, it will adjust the frequency and on the reverse link. This is a forward link, this is reverse link. Okay, it will adjust the power and it will transmit. Okay, this is how it is going to happen in case of closed loop control system. The power received on the reverse link at the base station is compared to the desired level, and the power differences is hard contact to obtain a power command bit that transmits to the user on the forward. Okay, what is happening here? A closed loop will be there. So here, this will be second part, that power control command will transmit to the beside the transmission power. After that, it will transmit back to the received power. So this is a closed loop. One is controlling to the other. It will sense the command, how much power you need to transmit back to the information to the base station. So it will transmit that much power utilized to transmit the information from mobile to the base station. So this is what we are calling it as a closed loop. Okay, so in this case, the power received on the reverse link, that is nothing but reverse link is nothing, mobile to the base station. Okay, at the base station, compared to the desired level, what is the desired level is nothing but what, how much power required to communicate from the user to the base station. That is the required power. Desired level is nothing, required power. And the difference power is hard quantizer to obtain the power command bit. So it will transmit a command stating that you need this much of power to transmit or to communicate the information to the base station. that is transmitted to the user in the forward link. Okay, the command bit is going to be transmitted in the forward link, and once command has been received by the mobile, the desired power is going to be activated to transmit the information from the mobile link to the base station. So power command changes user transmitter power by fixed step. That's what we are calling it. One is by means of soft quantizer, another one is going to be hard quantizer. The soft quantizer requires more number of bits to code the transmit power command. Okay. So more command bits means nothing but what it requires again, a more power. Okay. So what is going to happen while communicating these in case of a closed loop? So whatever the delay is going to be occurred in case of power control loop, the command bit is transmitted and the forward link is unprotected. Okay, due to unprotected calling, the delay has been changed, which has been leads to the channel error. This is what is not going to be okay. Demand. The port control can be used to follow only a slow log normal power variations caused by shadowing effect, where the signal remains correlated or track the rapidly fading effect. So this is going to reduce actually power control system. It will be controls the fading effect. It will controls the path losses. It will controls the mobile battery, maintains the power battery. So the power control system designed to mitigate fast multiple paths fading effect. The power updates sent at the much higher rate than the maximum fade rate at the receive signal. Okay. So this is what we supposed to study in the today's class. In the next class, I am going to consider the interference consideration in the cellular concept. Okay. Have you understood this today's class? Hello. So I'm going to engage day after tomorrow once again. Please unmute all of you your mobiles. Hello. Hello.
Yes, sir.
So I have received only less number of assignments. Hardly I have received 12 to 30. Most of you have not submitted.
Sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
So I have not received what do you call
assignment, sir?
What is the matter?
Don't know, sir.
Don't know. So I have to get everyone's assignment.
Sir. Sir, actually, many of them were saying that they are in remote villages, so that they are not having proper internet connection also, sir, for attending the classes.
How it could be? Huh? If they want to communicate,
sir.
If they want to communicate through WhatsApp, it is possible. When we will ask them to join, it's not possible then.
Yes, sir.
Because it will be a problem for them, Hindu.
Yes, sir.